This is from a recent novel of mine called Watergate. It's the first glimpse that the reader gets of the novel's one-woman witches chorus, Alice Roosevelt Longworth, Teddy Roosevelt's daughter, irrepressible. Roosevelt once said that he could control Alice or run the country, but not both. She was in Washington for 70 years, having married Nicholas Longworth, the Speaker of the House. And this little scene takes place on May 22, 1972. It's late at night, and Alice is watching the news, which features President Nixon, a friend of hers, who's in Moscow negotiating an arms control treaty. As Hunt's car passed 2009 Massachusetts Avenue, her DuPont Circle mansion, the lone occupant of the house's third floor bedroom, having heard from the television that Nixon might make Brezhnev the gift of a Cadillac, tried to recall what the Tsar of Russia had given her for a wedding present in 1906. She remembered Edward VII sending a snuff box with his face on it. She and Nick had never figured out whether it was intended for the bride or groom or both of them. But the Tsar? Maybe nothing. It seemed to the still sharp memory of Alice Roosevelt Longworth that that was right. Father had not long before made peace between the Russians and the Japanese, and the Russians had gotten rather the short end of the big stick. Yes, that was why the Japanese had outdone themselves with their present, bolt after bolt of that golden chrysanthemum-patterned silk. Not too different from the United Mine Workers sending that boxcar loaded with coal. Again, all about father and not about Alice. The miners had still been happy with the way he'd settled the coal strike in '02. Pat looked well, thought Mrs. Longworth, gazing over the top of her eyeglasses at the TV. The First Lady's hair might be teased a bit too high on her head, but she never got sufficient credit for being pretty, much prettier than Tricia, whom all the newspapers, no matter how they hated Dick, continually described as looking like a fairy princess, with that ridiculous retroussé version of Dick's ski nose, all wrong, and not an interesting word out of her, ever. Pat Nixon's televised image was gone too quickly for Mrs. Longworth to get a good look at her coat, which might still be cloth, but would have come, at the very least, from Elizabeth Arden. Even back in '60, some of Pat's outfits had cost more than Jackie's, not that the press ever had the wit to see it. Mrs. L., as she was resigned to being called, like both of them, always had. It was Jackie's mother-in-law, the detestable Rose, with that helmet of dyed black hair, who got on her nerves. 6 years Alice's junior, but forever babbling about how she'd met McKinley, as if he were Moses or Methuselah. Well, Alice Roosevelt had met Benjamin Harrison and didn't feel the need to squawk about it to every reporter who came along. And those lamentable Lily Pulitzer dresses Rose wore around Palm Beach, polka-dotted knee-length muumuus that could be shower curtains for all anyone knew, and which just hung against the form. She herself, since the second mastectomy, might be the world's best-known topless octogenarian, her own line, and a good one, too. But a bit of tailoring never hurt, even if it wound up accentuating one's deformity. Mrs. Longworth now realized that she would be in Florida in just 3 months for the convention. And good for Dick, who for once would arrive in the hall as president and not just candidate, and who these days appeared to be accomplishing something. She liked him, too. She told the newsmen all through his early days that he, unlike McCarthy, could actually think, sometimes even think big. The thing Dick couldn't do well was listen, an odd incapacity in one who curried favor so dutifully, tried so hard, at least with her. The two men she'd really like to have gotten around her dining room table together were Dick and Bobby. Well, too late for that, as it was for most things. Bobby had been even smarter than Dick and nearly as damaged. But he'd had the ability to approach her without neediness. Awe, yes, and who didn't like that? But he didn't come wanting to earn her esteem or affection, as if one could ever earn those things from anybody, as if they were meted out according to some fair scale of prorated hourly wages that Eleanor had drawn up. The thought of her distant cousin now made Mrs. Longworth buck out her teeth, as she'd done 1,000 times in imitation of her. No, one was paid esteem and affection according to the whims of the pair, whether one had shown up to work in the vineyard early or late. She was sure Dick knew no more of the Bible than what he got from Billy Graham over some prayer breakfast. Too bad. He might have some small sense of irony if he did, and having read it, he would at least know enough not to believe in God. Mrs. Longworth got up to raise the window and felt certain she could smell the honeysuckle coming up three stories from the garden below. She had a sprig of it on the night table beside the locket containing father's hair, which she now regarded. She'd often thought she would enjoy having his actual head mounted on the dining room wall, like one of the old elks at Sagamore Hill. Of course the Tsar had never sent a present. Father had never sent her to the Tsar. To Japan, yes, but not to Russia. The closest she'd ever gotten to it were those letters from Willard Strait, on whom she'd had such a nice off-and-on platonic case, until the flu made off with him after the First War. "You who are fond of the game would love it here," he'd written her from Moscow as the workers began their revolt the year before her wedding. Perhaps, it now occurred to her, the Tsar had just been too distracted to send a present. She was sure that Willard's letters were still in that bottom drawer with the pearls from Cuba and the bracelet from the Kaiser, the one whose diamonds had been stolen out of their settings that night a half dozen years ago when she went up to New York for Capote's party and so stupidly let the papers know in advance that she'd be out of town. The television turned its attention to the weather, whose forecast bored Mrs. Longworth more than the weather's actual and never varied arrival. Yes, she thought, shutting off the set and reaching for her book and letting her mind travel toward Willard Strait, I would have loved Russia in 1905 once the shooting started. Thank you.